Commissioner, can you hear me okay?
Great.
Thanks. Good evening, everyone. My name's Ryan Gook. Deaf Victoria has actually invited me here this evening to facilitate this important information session. There'll be lots of shared information. Maybe some of you are already aware, but some of you may not. So it's really important that we have a night like tonight to share that information. And we also have people online. We have live stream, which I think is fantastic for everyone. And it has us all connected. So there are two parts to tonight. Firstly, we have some information from Deaf Australia. They'll be talking about their membership structure and so forth. And after that, we'll have question and answers. We'll then move on to the second part, and that will be the new Auslan scheme. And they'll talk more about that and how it impacts on all of you here tonight. So first of all, I'd like to ask Marnie Kerridge, who is President of Deaf Victoria, and she will introduce herself and talk about how tonight will work. Welcome, Marnie. Thank you, Ryan. First of all, welcome to all of you here tonight. And I also want to thank up front Ryan for facilitating, also to Todd and Kyle for your attendance tonight. So there'll be lots of questions about the future of Deaf Australia, and I think it's a really valuable night to have. So we'll be talking about the structure of this evening. We're making sure that there's an opportunity for everyone who's here in attendance, but also online, to ask questions. We've got two Deaf Victoria board members. Sorry, we have three Deaf Victoria board members who will be watching out for the questions online, and they will take note of those, and we'll have someone who will actually ask those questions. When you do have a question, you need to come out to the front and ask your question. But before you do that, mention who you are so that we actually know who we're watching. And those who are online, please put down your name or whether you'd like it to be anonymous, so that we know who's actually asking the question. And when you're watching from online, you can type in your question at any time throughout the presentations. So that's it from me. Welcome to Todd Wright, who's President of Deaf Australia. He's actually flown especially for this session, so thank you for giving up the time. And I should also welcome our two life members, Anne Darwin and Barry Darwin, for being here also. Welcome. So I'll now hand the wallet over to Todd Wright. Thank you.
Hello, thank you everybody. My name's Todd, as you would be aware, so Chairperson of Deaf Australia. And I've been in this role since 2012, since the AGM, sorry, I should say 2013, correction. Up until now, and it has been an interesting time going through this experience, being the chair of Deaf Australia, because of the various changes that are taking place. The CEO will talk about that and look at the new challenges that we do face, but it is good to see everybody here in Melbourne and also everybody online at home. Welcome. So we'll talk a little bit about Deaf Australia and what is happening from now into the future. And I'm sure you've heard lots of news announcements that has been put out there about the government and the reduction in funding that's occurring to a lot of disability organisations and DPOs. So disability people organisations and how they have been affected. Deaf Australia is one of them, and we are going to be impacted by those changes. We won't be receiving funding as of the end of June onwards. So we're going to talk to you about what this actually means for us as an organisation. And once we've explained that, we'll also talk about the recent changes. If we could just go on to the next PowerPoint slide. So looking at the strategic plan, last year at the AGM, we launched the new strategic plan from 2015 through to 2020. So it's a 5-year plan. And that's important because there are a number of changes occurring. So in Australia, we have the changes with the up-and-coming NDIS, how that will affect deaf people throughout the country. And we know that we need more than the NDIS to satisfy our needs. So we need to ensure that we have an efficient strategic plan. Also looking at the new vision, so strengthening and growing the diversity within the deaf community. What does this actually mean, you might ask? It basically means that deaf people need to be involved, hard of hearing people, family, friends, hearing people, coders, so that we're a united force and that we can enhance diversity within Australia and certainly not fragment various groups that do exist. So they're all part of our diverse community as well, and we need to embrace them. So that's our vision. Our mission is to ensure that we have an inclusive Australia for deaf people. So what do we mean by inclusive? It means that we can access everyday life, employment opportunities, education, family, children having access, absolutely everything that's incorporated for deaf people so that we don't face any barriers in the future, and that is our mission. And hopefully that will enhance the vision and enable that to occur as well. Looking at the key goals within the strategic plan. First of all, looking at families, youth, community, services and members. And there'll be a lot of discussion about membership this evening. So if you're requiring further information about the strategic plan, please do have a look at the Deaf Australia website. And we have the Auslan version available around the strategic plan. And there is a English text version available as well. So as I mentioned, the strategic plan was launched last year. And at the same time at the AGM, we formed a new constitution and there were constitutional changes that passed through the special general meeting that we held. The changes in the constitution were outlined and the biggest change there was around deaf members and also hard of hearing membership as well. And what we were looking specifically about around the hard of hearing membership was those individuals who have felt that they could use Auslan but didn't necessarily label themselves as being capital D deaf. So Deaf Australia has really wanted to have Auslan represented, regardless if the individual is deaf or hard of hearing. But the fact is that we all share the same language, Auslan. So it meant that hard of hearing members could vote at the AGM and be recognised officially within our membership. And therefore, we're increasing the diversity within the deaf community as well. So that's one major change. Another major change is the structure of the board, and you're probably aware of who those members are. And unfortunately, we do have a lot of New South Wales-based people on the board currently. So we looked at that and we're aware with the constitution that previously it was limited to 2 per state being on the board. And then we had board of directors. So the board of directors, the treasurer, secretariat, it didn't really matter. So looking at that, we more recently made changes. So we had the chairperson, treasurer and secretary all from New South Wales and also a board of director from New South Wales as well. So we've had 4 people in those roles and we're really wanting to increase membership on the board Australia-wide rather than have it New South Wales-centric. So ensuring that we have a person from each state involved, regardless of which role that is. And more recently, we had the change of the secretary role through to the CEO as the company secretary. And that means that the board doesn't need a secretary. So we've got the president and the treasurer. So I am pleased that this change has occurred. It's something that I've wanted for a long time. And once that person's voted in, they're on for 3 years. So previously, they were only in that position as office bearer for 2 years. So that had meant that every 2 years, half the board members would leave and then we would recruit new ones. So all that experience and expertise was lost. So now it means that we only have 1/3 of those members who stand down from the board through those changes. also with the constitutional changes around membership, we'll talk to you about that further tonight, around the deaf-friendly concept. So the constitutional changes enabling us to move forward in a deaf-friendly fashion with that initiative, and I do thank the members for being involved in that change to the constitution. Another important change around the board is that previously we had 7 directors on the board, and now it's been decreased to 5. And that's because we're able to have robust discussion, and 7 members weren't needed for that, and were perhaps a little bit unnecessary. But now it also means that we can have 2 casual board directors who are involved in that process, and the board at the time can select individuals who have perhaps skills that they can bring to the board that we may be missing. So it might be marketing or fundraising, and target those individuals and invite them onto the board for a casual time or casual basis. And leading up to the AGM, we can actually confirm them as permanent board members to give the board more flexibility around being able to recruit the most appropriate people to be on the board at the time with the most appropriate skill sets. So those are the constitutional changes. The funding situation, as I mentioned, the Department of Social Services, DSS, the federal government. Previously, we were allocated funding to Deaf Australia for advocacy work. And now the government has decided that funding will cease and it will go to cross disabilities. So what I mean by that is the various groups who represent all disabilities in the organisations. So not specifically funding for blind organisations or autism or deafness. So the funding will go to an organisation to look after all disabilities. And the government has confirmed that that's how the allocation of funds will continue into the future. Disability Australia, Children with Disabilities Australia, Women with Disabilities Australia, to name a few. The National Ethnic Disability Alliance for newly arrived migrants who are involved in the country, and also the People's Disabilities Network, and also the Indigenous group. So as a result, the government has decided these people represent all of you, no longer Deaf Australia will be continuing in that role. It doesn't mean that Deaf Australia will close and cease to continue. We do strongly believe that we are a peak body representing your community and your rights to access Auslan, and that's key. And whilst those organisations do have experience, they don't necessarily understand deafness. And Deaf Australia has that experience and have a track record. So we do need your support, with your ongoing support with our organisation, for us to move forward. And tonight with the Deaf Friendly Initiative, that's key for us in terms of ensuring that that occurs. So we'll be providing more information around that this evening. In the financial report from the AGM, we looked at the last financial year and how 83% of the funds came from government. That's 83%. And now in June onwards, that 83% is going to disappear. So that's a massive change. So the board of directors have had firm discussions and really needed to think about new income streams that we could pursue. The Auslan workshops were increasing and we're wanting to increase further. Deaf-friendly initiatives, which we can earn a further income stream, and also that can enable us to achieve our strategy. So providing deaf awareness, accessibility, more recognition of Auslan throughout the country, and that's important. We'll also need to look into capacity projects. So government do provide support for one-off projects when you apply for funding. It's block funding and it's not continuous, so it is difficult to maintain salaries for staff and people who work in the office in a funding regime that's established like that. But it's important to be able to continue as a strong organisation, so we'll be looking at the various aspects around that. With the funding situation, we're looking at the next step. So really, being a deaf-friendly organisation is key. But also, there's a lot of other important advocacy work that we need to do for family, various groups, youth. And unfortunately, at this stage, they'll have to be put on hold because our main focus will be the Deaf Friendly Initiative to ensure that it all works for us and for you, and ensuring that it's effective for organisations throughout the country who service deaf people. So that's our main goal, and also funding, targeting various income streams. With advocacy, unfortunately, that will have to be put on hold for a while. The next workshop will be provided in Melbourne, the Auslan shop, so we will provide information around that, and people will be able to service that online too. We'll also be launching in June a big campaign, Save Deaf Australia. So please keep an eye out on Facebook and on the internet for information around that. And you out there can help us and assist us in advocating government and saying, look, we do need better representation for the deaf community. So please do look out for that information. That's it in a nutshell. And now I'll pass it out to the audience for questions around what I've just shared with you.
Thank you, Todd. So if anyone here has any questions, as you know, you need to come out front. Please let us know who you are and make sure that you ask a question rather than a comment, and then you can go and sit down. And so there's an opportunity to respond to those questions. So is there anyone online or anyone here tonight who would like to ask the first question? It seems very quiet. Well, obviously the information was very clear, Todd. If there's no questions from online, no? Okay, we'll move forward. So next, the next part for tonight, we have Kyle Mears. He is now the CEO of Deaf Australia. He'll come out front and talk about the Auslan Initiative. So over to you and welcome. Welcome, Kyle.
Thank you, Ryan. Thanks for the introduction, and thank you, Marnie, for organising this forum. It certainly is an important forum this evening. I'm Kyle Mears, CEO of Deaf Australia, and have been for the last 11 months, and I've been very busy in this role. When I came into the role, I knew that potentially funding could be a risk to this organisation. Despite that, I decided to take on the position because I was keen to see it survive. And with that in mind, my passion really has been around forming opportunities for deaf people in Australia to continue with this organisation and providing services for you people. As Todd mentioned earlier around the funding situation, as you would be aware, federal government cuts are happening, and we're looking at various income streams that we could potentially pursue. Looking at the traditional ways of asking for funding grants and putting in submissions, because government now is ceasing those types of programs and funding. So many organisations are competing with the funds that basically come from the same bucket. So there's now less opportunity for us to perhaps receive that funding than what there was in the past. So now we need to think differently. And that's our role, to try and think about how we can actually do this and create opportunities for Deaf Australia to move forwards into the future. First of all, I'd like to ask you a question around these symbols. Do you identify with these symbols? So the first one we have there is the ear with the cross through it, and also the interpreter symbol. So just envisage this. The ear symbol was agreed to WFD and the Hard of Hearing Organisation and WFD as an international symbol. A symbol to demonstrate deafness. Over the years, this has been used to let people know that hearing loops were available and various other devices. And at WFD in Canada, they decided to cease this symbol in terms of being representative of the deaf community. And traditionally, there was no symbol to recognise deaf people's language, sign language. up until this point of time. The interpreter symbol, we've seen this at various events. We often see that symbol, and when a deaf person comes along, I guess we ask, are they an interpreter or are they a person who uses sign language? So it's been quite vague around how we could resolve those issues, and just wanting to clarify for deaf individuals what our roles are and how it differs to somebody who's an interpreter or hard of hearing. Is everybody following? I don't know what's happening with the technology. I'll just go over and have a look at the laptop. Okay, so the deaf-friendly concept. Thinking about what this actually means. First of all, identifying deaf individuals, deaf people, and hearing people who perhaps are familiar with Auslan too. So we have those groups. And what are the opportunities that lie there? As we know, many hearing people do use and understand Auslan. What about the workplace? Perhaps this is missing. Many deaf children, parents of deaf children are wanting to learn sign language in the community. They're not able to find courses. They're cost prohibitive. They don't necessarily run at the times that suit parents. They might need to travel to a different location. And somebody might want to find a deaf plumber, perhaps. Where can you locate a deaf plumber? We all ask our friends and community members, and often it's hard to find these deaf professionals. And where do we go to get this information? If we travel overseas, we might want to locate a deaf group that operates within that country or state, and we don't have access to it. So the information is very vague about our community. We know that it exists, but how do we tap into that, and how do we market that appropriately? So what are people's thoughts around this and how can we enhance it? We talk about assessment and people feel strongly about why would you assess somebody for Auslan? You don't need to be concerned because we'll provide further information shortly. Employers and businesses providing Auslan for perhaps staff who can sign. We do have staff who are skilled in Auslan in various workplaces. And sustainable strategy. So we'll go through these four main points. No questions from the people watching online at this point in time? Okay, I'll move on to my next slide. Just so we know, we've got 26 people online at the moment. That's fantastic, and hopefully that number will increase throughout this evening. So including the people in the room, we've got about 50 or 60 people here. So that's a great number to start off with. This symbol I have on the slide here, we can see demonstrates signing. Sorry, do I need to reposition myself for the camera? Okay. So this represents signing. We've got blue and white for the disability standards, because often you'll see the disability symbol is in blue and white, and the various other symbols that we have out there. So we're ensured that we're consistent with that colour and that theme. This symbol has now been submitted to World Federation of the Deaf to consider, along with the deaf-friendly scheme for WFD to look at the next Congress in July in Turkey. And should this be ratified, this will become an international symbol of the sign language of deaf people throughout the world. And this was a Deaf Australia initiative. The outcomes, does anybody know how many deaf people exist in Australia? 2,000? More than 2,000? 9? 20,000? The numbers vary. There's no definite number of how many people use sign language in Australia. We don't actually have those statistics. We have the statistics from the 2011 census who states that there's 9,000 signing deaf people, but as many of us know, there's probably more than that. As much as we advocated for people to understand that process, a lot of people didn't necessarily fill that part in the census. Trevor Johnson, back in 1992, stated there was about 16,000 deaf people, but are we sure? And he even argued that it's probably now reduced to 8,000. So what are the actual figures of sighting deaf people and the numbers in Australia? And how many hearing people know Auslan? We don't know the statistics around that. We know there's many, but whether it's 1,000, 200, a million, or 500,000, we really don't have an idea. There's no accurate figure. Once we have that number, we can actually advocate to government for further funding and support. But at the moment, without those numbers, it's difficult to do so. So we often advocate for various issues and projects, and they'll ask us, how many people do you have who sign? And if we give them a small figure, they don't consider us as significant enough to be able to support. So for advocacy purposes, it's a very good reason for us to have those statistics available. Employers, many employers have deaf staff who work for them. As we know, there's quite a few. How many employers have hearing staff who are aware of Auslan and can use sign language? Nurses, doctors, dentists. We know they're all out there. But where are they? Do you all know where they are? We don't have those statistics. So again, we don't have the numbers there and we're facing the additional barriers. So how can we actually get the statistics and the evidence to support the advocacy we require for the deaf community to look at this deaf-friendly concept? The fee structure. We'll talk a little bit about that further on as to how we've worked out the fee structure. And some people consider it a large change compared to the traditional way of doing things and the new way that we're looking at. Previously, you paid $30 for a year, annual membership, $10 we kept, $20 went to the state branch, such as Deaf Victoria, the South Australian branch, and so on. And that's how it was distributed. So we only held on to a small proportion of the funds that were allocated through membership. As a percentage, it wasn't a lot of money for us as a national organisation or the state branch. With the deaf-friendly concept and the fee structure there, there'll be more benefits to deaf people as individuals. So you would pay through this structure as a one-off fee, and in return would be a life member of Deaf Australia. And then we would also use hearing people and companies and organisations to support Deaf Australia through our fee structure. Risks, you might ask? Yes, there is a big risk. There are large employers out there and we figure that they could actually support us in providing for your services, providing funding for access, using them to support us through this process to advocate for our work. Is it sneaky? No, I don't think it is. I think it's a good way to get these people in on board and be part of the deaf community, being an inclusive deaf community by incorporating these groups and organisations and employers. I think I've pretty much covered these points, but the other benefits I wanted to outline were many employers, for example, who employ nurses who might have signing skills. Do they receive an additional income or a bonus in their salary if they know another language? Perhaps not sign language, but if they can speak Russian or some other spoken language. It may not be the case in Auslan, but we need to encourage those employers to make Auslan a valuable tool and see that it's recognised so they can recruit people with Auslan skills through and recognise that through remuneration. Information dissemination, having it widely distributed, making it easy for us, and I guess also increasing the database. So when we go into a database and we look at an employer or a company, and if we have 5,000 deaf people who are perhaps interested in car insurance, that we could actually negotiate with an insurance company and say, look, within our membership you can do a deal with deaf people, they're generally safe drivers, can we have a discount? So having information to access various companies and services. At the moment, as soon as we approach somebody, they ask us for the statistics, we end up in this argument, and it always goes back to the numbers that we have that we don't have the evidence to provide. And that's the key problem. The Sustainable International Initiative, and that will assist Deaf Australia in recurrent funding that continues to come directly to us. And with that funding, it enables us to do what we want to do without the government dictating what we can or can't do, because we're relying on their funds. If we create our own income streams, then we can decide what we do with the funds. And hopefully with that, be able to provide sponsorship and those types of initiatives. Fund the community for various projects. And having a think about, if we do have the support of the community and employers and companies, we could easily raise $1 to $2 million every 2 to 3 years if it is effective. And in the long term, it's a lot more than what we receive currently. Again, a different viewpoint and a different approach. Discussion around assessment, and I think it's one of the most controversial discussions that we're having. How will it impact you? I guess with hearing people, they're assessed with English anyway, whether it's through various courses, their various competencies to ensure that they satisfy those competencies. Nothing actually exists for deaf people and signing people at the moment. They acquire the sign language through the community. We understand that, but how do we assess it? So we're looking at the proficiency, not your ability. So they are two separate things. We understand we look at linguistics, but that's not where what we're intending to do. We're looking at their proficiency. Can they communicate fluently? Various questions will be asked around proficiency, but that's all we're focusing on at this point in time. Who will assess? An independent assessor who is an expert in linguistics, who can assess your skills. And that person would be deaf, has a PhD or various other qualifications, load qualifications, and ideally have a team of people working with them, assessors who are deaf themselves. Not hearing people, but deaf people doing the assessments of language proficiency. So we're creating opportunities for that group of people also to be able to assess and raise funds for their time that's taken to be involved in this assessment process. At the moment, we've recruited Dr. Donovan Cresdy, and he now is assessing an assessment tool. And once he's completed that, then we'll be advertising for a team of assessors who will then report to Donovan and then receive 1 or 2 full days training and look at the ins and outs of what we're actually looking for. And the assessment would be no longer than 15 minutes. No longer than 15 minutes. A short assessment and looking at your proficiency and skills and communication. With the research that Donovan has done, he's looked at sign language assessment that's occurred internationally and found that in the United States, through Gallaudet University, they have the ASLPI, the American Sign Language Proficiency. Can't remember what the I stands for. But they have different levels from 0 up to 4. And the rating 0 is somebody who is definitely not proficient. So they would ask a question. If they responded inappropriately, that person ideally wouldn't pass that assessment process. And then number 1 would be someone perhaps who could still sign a little bit but is not able to answer the question proficiently, and then somebody who's able to converse and talk about issues around a conversation in a coffee shop perhaps for 5 or 10 minutes, maybe rated at that point. And then somebody who's 4 or 5 would then be much more proficient and perhaps be an interpreter. And we would have demonstration videos to highlight those differences so that they could compare with what your level of proficiency is, and to give you a better understanding of how that system operates. So those videos will be available on the website. the impacts on the wider community. So deaf people have often said, well, I've come from a deaf family, I've been signing all my life, how can you assess me? That's true, but there's also many others out there who perhaps were taught the language at school who are not so proficient. So we just need to clarify the categorisation around this, who's proficient, who can actually work in an appropriate environment depending on their skill level of communication. And we're really encouraging employers and companies to do the right thing by us by acknowledging this assessment and categorisation. Will it have an impact on interpreters? No, but for hearing people who wish to learn Auslan, really creating a pathway for those people to go on to learn Auslan and eventually become interpreters. So then there is benefits to the interpreting industry as well that come out of this. And then eventually looking at families who perhaps arrive at a childcare centre or a creche. If their child needs sign language input, that they have deaf staff who are there or hearing staff who can teach their child how to sign at the childcare centre. The impacts are enormous. NDIS is probably not going to cover off all these issues. Yes, they will cover some of these issues, but certainly not all of them. And there's gaps there that we feel that we can cover through this initiative. The eligibility criteria, so for hearing people doing Cert 4 or better in Auslan. Those who are involved in the deaf community, who perhaps have acquired skills through social networks and don't have appropriate qualifications, but they are involved in the community and they do have that social conversational level that's available to them, could perhaps be involved. And also coders, for example, and providing evidence of where you acquired the language from. There's a registration process, and through that, the person would be assessed and then we would get the ball rolling from there. So it really is not a big deal, as you can see. I think it's important to say that this symbol will not be replacing interpreters, the International Sign Language symbol. And so if somebody goes off to an employer, they understand that that person's not an interpreter, they need to be provided with information saying that you are not an interpreter, and it distinguishes what their role is and their boundary. If they do require an interpreter, then that person needs to go through the appropriate training to be a qualified interpreter. Symbols being used alongside the deafness symbol for the loop system. So for example, if we think about theatre performances, often we have deaf people or interpreters there looking at the symbols that are provided that aren't currently provided. So using that sign language symbol so that they understand it's a deaf person who's signing, and that's different from the interpreter role, because as we know, we do have deaf people who are involved in that process providing interpreting also at theatre performances. Producing videos. Many times we see a person signing on a video and they're deaf, but they've got an interpreter symbol. So they would have the sign language symbol to indicate that that person who is signing is actually deaf, it's not an interpreter. At the hospital, having a sticker that's made available on your file that states that you are a signing deaf person, so hospital staff can book an interpreter for you for that appointment. And there are various avenues or ways of being able to use this system. Who would receive this? What services? The Deaf Society, Deaf Services. So we could have that up on the website. And people could be referenced to that. So we could have a deaf business directory through the internet, where that logo is used to indicate you're a deaf-friendly service. Employment services. Hospitals and tourism centres could use these logos the tourism centre might have a video that's providing like the Open Me device initiative. So if somebody's not aware of that, they can have that symbol there saying that sign language access is provided, so an Auslan version is available. Hospitals, cafes might be able to use this symbol, other shops where sign language is used, and so people can identify that it's deaf-friendly. Deaf professionals, deaf dry cleaners, plumbers, tradies, so that deaf people can actually select the services they wish to use to be able to have communication in their first language. Big businesses, Bunnings, IBM, the possibilities are endless. We certainly do see wonderful opportunities arising out of this. Education or private school tuition. So this role wouldn't be for somebody to replace a teacher of the deaf, but for somebody to come in and teach sign language in the school so that deaf children have access to language in their preferred language. Sustainable strategies. Looking at social enterprise. And social enterprise is a wonderful opportunity to provide business and government recognising that there's an interest in various models. And we've talked to a number of disability organisations like Down Syndrome Association and Autism, and they're quite keen to use these models, and we can actually adapt this to our target audience's needs. And I think for the deaf community, this could translate and further enhance commission or fundraising for our organisation to support Deaf Australia going forward through these types of businesses and social enterprise. Community participation, so you've got local government access being provided there. A lot of people ask the question, how can we make this event accessible? And we could actually refer them on to various businesses that they can use and select them to make sure that their service is accessible for any deaf person to attend at any point in time. Information to databases, so when you register information, that information we collate will certainly help us as an organisation. Having that rich set of resources, knowing where people live demographically, where they work, where they're employed, what they actually do, and all those statistics enable us to advocate through government to give definite numbers of deaf people that we're aware of that do exist throughout the country. And of course we will miss out on some of those figures, but the more stats that we have, the better are we off than we ever have been before. Targeted benefits, so insurance companies as an example. If we have the numbers, we can negotiate and provide a deal for you at a discounted rate. And we can't do that with $30 a year, obviously. Income. As I said previously, if it's established appropriately, we have a robust structure, we could earn $1 to $2 million annually on an annual basis. So that's a huge income stream. So the potential and the opportunity is there. Leaving that to one side, we'll talk a little bit about the membership fee structure. And there are large changes occurring here in the new constitution compared to the old constitution. So with the fee structure, Todd talked about previously how we decided to get rid of the fixed fee within the constitution. And the state organisations like Deaf Victoria, South Australia and so on, every year we weren't able to negotiate fee increases, so we've decided to change it in the constitution and start off from scratch. Through the AGM, we looked at increasing the fees and various arguments occurred every year, and we really struggled with how we could change this and sort out this issue. So now with new allowances through the constitution, we have flexibility around the fee structure, and hopefully at the next AGM, we can negotiate with the state organisations and say, look, we can increase the fee or decrease it, depending on what the issues are at the time, with the local state branch. And the state branches will have more bargaining power to look at the fee structure and have more input to the discussions around that, whereas previously they didn't have much of a say at all. The new system. So first of all, looking at the deaf-friendly initiative and also the membership arrangement for Deaf Australia and the local state branch. And also we have a third tier that looks at businesses, but that's separate. I won't be talking about that this evening. So with the deaf-friendly initiative, deaf people pay $100 as a one-off fee, and that's it. You pay $100 and that's all. You provide your details and information. We have the assessment, you pass the assessment, and then you're on our database and we have the information ready for us. We contact your employer and may ask them would they like deaf awareness training provided. And we can say that we can work with the state provider to provide the deaf awareness training through this initiative. So there's huge opportunities that are going to be available to us, as you can see. If you don't want to do this, you can be just a regular member and either pay $30 over 4 years for $120 or just pay the $100 as a one-off lump sum fee. The percentages that are allocated from those funds are different. So with the fee that's paid for the assessment, the admin costs that are involved in Deaf Australia, we need to look at that. But with the secondary amount, two-thirds goes to the state and one-third comes to the national branch. So it might be $66 to the state branch and we receive $33 out of that. But if you decide that you change your mind and you want to go back to the new system, we just need to pay for the assessment arrangement. So you do have further options. A hard of hearing person can join as an individual member, that's not an issue. If somebody who's hard of hearing who can sign, they can be part of the deaf-friendly program. So again, there's options for those individuals and it's entirely up to you. The third group, so as I mentioned, corporate organisations, businesses, for example, the Deaf Society, who perhaps wants to be a member of Deaf Australia, would either join through the deaf-friendly initiative or as an individual associate member and have individual membership as an organisation. As you can see, we have Schedule A, B and C. So we've got the ordinary members, those who are hard of hearing and deaf. That's $30 or $100 as a one-off. So the $30 fee would be for 4 years and the $100 fee is a one-off fee. The associate membership, so for those who are hearing who have an interest in deafness or sign language or perhaps can sign themselves and they're not deaf, can be a member but they don't actually have voting rights. The honorary life members, both from Deaf Victoria at a state level or the national level, don't need to pay a fee. The junior members, is it worth keeping that? We've had that for many years and we've never had any junior membership or people take that on board. Schedule B, corporate members, state and territory organisation members. If we've only got five, they might join up as a state member and they don't need to pay a fee. The ordinary corporate membership, so looking at more than 50% of those people being deaf board members and they can join up as corporate or ordinary members and actually have voting rights at the AGM. Associate corporate members, so they might be deaf organisations or hearing organisations, regardless, if they have less than 50% deaf board membership, then they're not able to vote at the AGM. So I hope that clarifies that for you. So for the deaf organisations, it's $50 a year, where the majority of the board are deaf. And with the previous system, we struggled looking at the organisation and what their income was and how we charged the fee. If it went up from $100,000 to $250,000, and it was really quite confusing for us. So we're just looking at a one-off flat fee. The associate corporate membership, so for example, schools or church groups, and providing a discounted rate. So rather than pay $250, they might pay $50. Is everybody following me so far? The Deaf Friendly Initiative, like the ordinary membership fee, there's also benefits. As individual members, you have the same benefits as an ordinary member. There's no difference. For hearing people, it means that they can have membership for 5 years. They're probably not going to remember Auslan for 5 years or even further if they haven't used sign language for quite some time. Naturally, their Auslan skills will decrease over time, but it's a good opportunity for us to get the TAFEs thinking about developing new refresher courses through the TAFE system or community courses to be able to develop those people's skills to ensure that their signing is up to date and they can continue the membership for a further 5 years and so on. Service organisations becoming members, and they would sign up for 2 years and pay $250 to be members for 2 years. And that information would be allocated in the Deaf Business Directory, which would be online. We'd have a list of various companies that people could look at if they prefer to use them as a preferred provider. So creating opportunities for the deaf community and financial incentives for people and organisations as well. How do you register online? We already have some information available and I can demonstrate how you can find that. And you'll need to tick off various questions, whether you can sign or not, put in your personal details, your address. They'll ask you what your current employment is, and then we will follow up after we receive those details. You pay online with the ordinary membership, not through the Deaf Friendly Initiative. If you're wanting to pay $100, you can, or pay $30 annually over 4 years. That decision's entirely up to you. And those payments can be deducted over time. The process. So the information in black, we're looking at step one and two, the online registration and the payment. So that information is for your purposes. 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7, that is really our responsibility. So you're responsible for parts or steps one and two. And then we contact the assessors. They will then do the assessment, post you the membership with the various details once you've gone through that process. And then we'll contact your workplace and see if they're interested in being part of this Deaf Friendly Initiative or scheme. And they'll pay the $250. And if they would like to have deaf awareness training through the Employment Assistance Fund that some of you would be aware of, we can negotiate with the Employment Assistance Fund for them to be aware of these organisations and the programs that can be provided, and ensuring that deaf people can access $6,000 worth of interpreting, because a lot of people aren't aware of that, certainly employers aren't. So we are in a good position to be able to filter that information through. And we're in a good position to negotiate with deaf awareness training and negotiate with the state branches to provide that opportunity going forwards. once they're registered, we have them listed in the Deaf Directory Business Database, where you can actually peruse the list of companies that are there and think about what services you'd like to access. And then we also look at training that might be provided. So we're kind of the broker, the middle person. Todd just wants to add something. Todd? I just wanted to add there, Kyle. I've represented the Board of Deaf Australia, and the reason why the board does support this deaf-friendly initiative is for a number of reasons, which I'll go through now. But one of the things around the membership and the reason why we changed that structure of the annual fee to an ongoing fee and people becoming life members, it means that traditionally the numbers have fluctuated year in, year out. People have forgotten to renew their membership time and time again, and that's been an issue. And the payments have not been regular, so we've had an inconsistent number. And like Kyle said, it's hard to track how many deaf people there are that exist in Australia and where they exist, whether they live in metropolitan regions or country regions. And as a one-off fee, it means that we have an increase in the numbers in the membership, and we can look at the stats, and we have further opportunity to be able to use that evidence of how many deaf people do live and reside in Australia. And the board does see a wonderful opportunity, particularly with NDIS coming up, around planning and recommending services. With the NDIS, the planner doesn't necessarily know which services provide access, but with this and the sign language, the signing symbol, it means that we can refer these organisations or company who have accessible signing or AUSLAN to the NDIS, so deaf people know to where to go through their planner, and there's better opportunity for NDIS to succeed. And that's the most important thing, wouldn't you agree? Some of you may or may not be aware, but, you know, if... What's going on here with the technology, Kyle? One day, as a deaf person, if I decide to move to Melbourne, some of you may be pleased or upset about that, who knows, but if I decided to move down from Sydney to Melbourne, I might think, okay, where are the accessible services? I was aware of them in Sydney, but I didn't know where they were in Melbourne, and I'd have to ask through my networks, but rather than doing that, it'd be all there at a one-stop shop online where I could access the services that are available in Melbourne. And perhaps if you were to go up to Sydney and find out about accessible services, you a click of a button, you would be able to find that information and be able to converse with somebody using AUSLAN. So there's so many advantages to this system, and that's why the board has approved of this deaf-friendly initiative. We'll open up the floor to questions.
Thank you to both Kyle and Todd. Thank you so much for all that information. It's now time for questions, and we have ample time. So, firstly, we'll start with a person who is actually on live stream, and they've actually posed a question. So, can we have someone at the back? There's five questions. Okay, we'll start with one, and then we'll go to the audience here in Melbourne, just to be fair. A list of questions here from online. First question is from Llewellyn Jones. His question is, if people who are assessed and they don't actually pass that assessment, are they given some tips or information as to how they can improve their AUSLAN skills? Would they be recommending a mentoring role? Do you want me to go through all the questions, or shall you respond to one? Just one. Okay.
Thank you for that question. It is an important question. I know that many deaf people are concerned about whether they're going to pass or fail this assessment, and I do assure you there's no need to worry. And certainly there is an opportunity if the assessors feel their sign language skills aren't up to scratch, that they do have encouragement and support. And we know that sometimes language acquisition is not enough, but there will be support to enhance people's skills. And of course, we will have Auslan training programs pop up, I think, because of this scheme. So there are going to be more and more people who want to be involved in this process, and people wanting to be part of our database, whether it's a refresher course or enhancing their Auslan skills, something like this will be available. So we do support that. You're not going to fail and that's the end of it. You'll have the opportunity to develop your skills. Thank you. Can I add to that, Kyle, as well? People might ask, why don't you just give it to us? Why do we need to be assessed? We actually need to protect the integrity of the organisation and of Auslan. So as you know, there is Makaton. A lot of people think it's Auslan. We know it's not. It's a basic form of signing. And Auslan is a language, whereas Makaton isn't. So we need to keep it as a language and not have the value of the language diminish over time. So the assessment is not about the individual, it's about the language and preserving the language. And that will certainly assist us ensuring that the language maintains and is strong in the future.
Thank you, and thank you, Luelle, for your question. So from the audience, do we have a question? Hello, I'm Melanie from Deaf Victoria, and I have a question for you. With regards to the assessment, how much is that?
It's $100 inclusive in your fee, so that includes your membership and your assessment, and also being a member of the state organisation too. So it's all inclusive through that $100 amount. There's no additional cost.
Thank you, Mel. We have another question online, so over to Stephen. We have Lana Barnett. It doesn't say where she's from. I think that's very similar to a question that was just asked before. But if you're interviewing and assessing the person for 15 minutes, how much would that cost Deaf Australia for that process?
How much is it worth to Deaf Australia? Well, Deaf Australia has already worked out a fee structure and the certain amounts that will go to different areas. So we've already allocated, I guess, $30 for the assessment fee out of that amount approximately, and maybe slightly more. But 10% would go to the state organisation, as an example, 20% to manage the admin process, another 5% to other components, but that's all included in the fee the person pays, and the assessment's part of that.
Thank you for that question. Now we move on to Robin Beasley. Good evening, I'm Robin. My question is, the Deaf Friendly Initiative, the cost is actually $100. Does that person have to still pay, when they pay and if they fail that assessment, do they then have to pay another fee to be assessed? So, and is there a time limit as to how many times?
For people who fail the assessment component, there will be an opportunity to be reassessed, an appeal process, so you'll be able to do that. If you do fail the test, then there'll be a second person who can assess you. If you fail that, then we'll negotiate how we can actually support you in enhancing your skills. In terms of the time frame, I guess you'd need to be linked in for assessment again. You know, we would need to look at that. if you were not able to be a deaf-friendly member, you'd receive the ordinary membership anyway for 5 years if you weren't eligible for the deaf-friendly initiative. If the person polishes their skills over time, we would give them an opportunity, but they would still be listed as an ordinary member for 5 years if they don't pass the assessment. And they have the opportunity to seek out refresher courses and then could end up in the deaf-friendly initiative later on. And yes, they would have to pay the additional $100 at a further point in time to do that.
Thank you, Robin, for your question. Now moving on to our third question online. Not really a question, but more of a consideration for Deaf Australia. It's from Bobby Blackson, who resides in Queensland. The Commonwealth Bank, who has billions of surplus, okay, there are many members within the workforce that can sign. So if you're charging $250 to an organisation that size, what do you think? So would there be a scale for businesses?
Thank you, Bobby. I am aware that larger organisations, particularly corporates, hire many staff who can sign. They don't necessarily work in one location. They're scattered throughout various locations. And the $250 is per location, per site. So if you have 50 of them, it'll be 50 times $250, not just a one-off for the Commonwealth Bank. So wherever the person is located or working at, that branch within that location would pay that fee. Could I just add there, Kyle, it is important to let you know that why we decided on the flat fee was it's easier for admin purposes, not having to go into further details around people, their earning and what membership capacity they have. And really, it's about raising the awareness of Auslan throughout Australia. So as a trade-off, we're wanting to recruit or increase membership and also look at an additional income stream. And if it becomes too expensive, we have less people joining up, and then if we have a cheaper amount offered, then we're not increasing our income stream. And every 2 years, we'd be looking at that fee for businesses and corporates who are interested.
Thank you again, and thank you to Bobby. We now have a question from Melissa Anderson. Before Melissa gets up, just to let you know that there are a ton of questions online, so it's a perfect opportunity for you to ask your question. We have Todd and we have Kyle here tonight from Deaf Australia, so please ask your question. Now over to Melissa. I'm Melissa Anderson. I know it's been confirmed, but I want to say up front that it's ridiculous. It's discriminating, and there could be lots of prosecutions with the ADA. I think it's a mess. This assessment tool that you have is such a no-no. It's just an awful thing that you should have for deaf people. If someone's going to assess me, fuck off. Seriously. No way. I just want to be a member. And, you know, as you know, Deaf Victoria have their structure in place, and it's their responsibility to look at the skill level. And at Aurora, with my work there, they have their own responsibilities. We just want to be a member. Can we just keep to that? Not assessments. I just think this whole initiative is ridiculous. I will never be a member of this deaf-friendly initiative. Sorry.
Did you want a response, Melissa, or did you want to leave that just as a comment? I'm happy to respond. I think think we need to remember the Deaf Friendly Initiative is only an option. You can either go with that or you don't have to. You continue to be an ordinary member. But as a personal example, if I wasn't on the board, I'd look at that and think, okay, the Deaf Friendly Initiative actually gives us the sign language symbol, right? And that's all. And the assessment gives us that symbol. And previously I've been asked to provide workshops, and I could actually register as an individual deaf business. So at least if I've got that symbol registered with me, that I can actually not teach Auslan, but provide information through Auslan as a registered individual and support the organisation with a strategic plan. So wouldn't that be better than somebody who's never heard of me, and at least they can actually ask for my help? Deaf businesses, cafes, all individuals are not required to use this symbol. If you don't want to, and you don't want to be part of the Deaf Initiative, that friendly initiative, that's fine. And it's really about the recognition of language. We're not out there to have a go at deaf people about their proficiency. If people receive that symbol, it means that, you know, they truly are proficient in the language. And if we go to a business and we start signing to somebody who perhaps has the symbol there and they aren't proficient, that's an issue. And we need to protect the integrity of our language. And there's deaf individuals who use signed English that we're aware of, and they go out there and say they can use Auslan. I am using Auslan in their signed English, and we know it's not Auslan. So how do you prevent that from happening? So it's a good educational tool. And we see this as increasing awareness out there about Auslan being preserved and recognised as deaf people's language and not for anybody to use, and having an impact in that manner. So not just thinking about our group as a whole, but how it affects government and education and everybody else and those ramifications. I do accept your view, but I do strongly believe that most members will benefit from this. And for those of you who don't want to do that, that's fine. I'm happy and do respect your decision.
Thank you, Melissa, for your statement. We have another question from online. Can you see me okay? I have a question from Shane Mundy. The question is, what is the risk involved when you pay that $100 fee? So from there on, what are the risks? Will there be another payment? So if things don't work to plan, and with the strategy that you have in place, what would you do?
Thank you, Shane. Like we said previously, as you can see, it's a big change in the way of thinking because of how we receive our funding. And people paying the one-off fee is part of the process, but most of our work will be directed to businesses and companies who do have the money in their pockets to support us. And every 2 years we're looking at receiving those funds. At the moment, people pay $30 a year. That's $60 over 2 years. And if you think about the $250 fee, there's a huge price difference, and we're going to increase our income through that revenue stream. So this really is to support our position in representing deaf people and our language and ensuring that we have that deaf-friendly initiative so we can seek further funds from those companies and organisations. One recent board discussion occurred around this was that previously with the old way it was a major issue, and the reason being was that Deaf Australia would ask for money from deaf people. So we're asking you, who generally are not well off, it's the larger community out there that we thought we should be targeting. How can we get them to support us as part of an inclusive society? So the deaf community ideally shouldn't be the target for us as revenue raisers. It should be people within Australian society as a whole, so we can support our organisation and larger organisations, and that means we can support you and represent you better.
Thank you again, and thank you to Shane's question. Moving on, we now have Meg. Thank you, Ryan. Orman. Can you see me okay? Hopefully I'm in the right position. Great. If you have a person who's very much involved in the deaf community, who's oral, who's not proficient with Auslan and they fail the assessment, can they still join the board of Deaf Australia? I'm a little bit confused, I guess. Can you just clarify the position there? Would it affect their voting right as well? Thank you, Todd.
Just in response to your question, Meg, it's a two-pronged approach. We do accept hard of hearing individuals to be voting members, and the hard of hearing individuals can also be represented through the assessment process if they succeed, but if they don't pass that assessment, they won't receive that symbol, but they can be associate members instead. Kyle's just saying hard of hearing voting membership. So with the new system, it means that hard of hearing individuals can vote. They still can vote for Deaf Australia at the AGM. Yes, they can vote at the AGM. So it means we're becoming more inclusive. So remember, with our vision, we're wanting to strengthen diversity and include hard of hearing individuals, their views and their values, and respect them as well. There's been big discussions at board meetings around this, particularly around the second point, Meg, about how can Deaf Australia protect the board and the governance process. Because the board has to represent deaf people. They're our key, those who use Auslan. So if we allow hard of hearing members to be part of the board down the track, we could eventually have an entire board made up of hard of hearing individuals. So we really want to see the board be deaf members, not hard of hearing members. That's our reasoning around that. So signing deaf members on the board. With the Constitution, it does say that if the members are wanting to change how the board operates, and if they want hard of hearing individuals on the board who don't sign, they can do that, but they need 100% of the votes. We need all members to agree to that, to change the constitution, to allow that change to happen. That's something people are thinking about. Does that make sense? So it means that all of you still have control about who is on the board and ensuring that signing deaf people stay on the board. And the five board of directors who have the membership vote, I mentioned before the two casual directors. Those two casual directors can be hearing and they can be hard of hearing. And that balances it out, respecting diversity and strengthening the skill sets that we have, because sometimes we don't have that skill set within the signing deaf community and we're able to second people for that period and to enable us to be more flexible.
Thank you, Meg, for your question. Now we have a question from Vanessa. Welcome. Thank you, Ryan. It's my question, but also just some other questions that have been posed too as well. There's a lot of hearing parents with deaf kids, as you know. So deaf children and their parents, the parents themselves can't vote. And I think that's an unfair situation because they have a deaf child and I think they have a right to vote. That's a statement. Also, hearing people must pay every 5 years. Again, that's not fair for hearing parents because they're already paying thousands of dollars to learn Auslan. Nothing's free in this world. So we're talking about access here. And we're asking for, you know, these families to be paying those fees every 5 years, I think is unfair. So they're my two comments and questions for you to respond to.
Thank you, Vanessa. It's more about governance. So what does the Constitution stand for? DPO, Disabled People's Organisation, and Deaf Australia is one of the DPO organisations. Many DPO organisations don't have hearing parents who are able to vote on their boards. They can only join as associate members. So that occurs quite widely out there. we need to look at the importance of creating pathways for parents to learn Auslan. Because families of deaf children don't have access to Auslan to start with, and we know from day one they're seeking advice and there might only be one place where they can learn, and they might prefer to learn at a local childcare centre with their child and interact with them from day one to develop their skills. So it's more giving parents better opportunities to access a variety of Auslan programs or courses in the wider community for their children to develop through Scout programs as an example. Sorry, I'll get back to that point. Scouting programs. But I must say, looking at parents having voting rights, access to Auslan, I'm sure many hearing people out there have good skills and have done so for a number of years, but there's many more who don't. So how do we weigh that up and say, yes, you can continue to be a member, and then we say no to somebody who has to pay every 5 years? So where do we draw the line? And then we have more of an administrative role dealing with that, so that's something we need to consider about parents who are fluent in signing and parents who are not. We are in the early stages of this process at this point in time. Down the track, we will have an opportunity to review this and perhaps not be so rigid in this process. So it's a perfect opportunity to talk about the changes and the membership fee structure and give us an opportunity to tweak the system and look at that and allow more flexibility than we have in the past. So for the time being now, we're really focused on developing the system, getting it up and running. And if we recognise down the track that further work needs to be done, then we will look at tweaking it and how we can do things better. There's a very good question about why parents can't vote. Who generally decides to vote at AGMs? Our AGM, it's deaf members, because it's your decision. It's your decision to assist us in developing the constitution. Previously, parents of deaf children have not been able to vote. That's not anything new. Other organisations do represent the PODC, represent parents of deaf children, and we ideally want to work with them on issues around being parents of deaf children. So our main focus is the deaf child, and they're more aligned to the PODC. So we do believe that that's a collaborative approach, and if members don't agree with me, they can raise that as a special item at the AGM if they wish to change the constitution. It's entirely up to you, and it is your decision because it's your organisation.
Thank you to Vanessa. Anne, do you have a question? Welcome, Anne. Hi, everyone. My name's Anne Bremner. I have a question and also a statement, maybe a few, actually. My question is, you've actually stated that Deaf Australia is an organisation for deaf people, and no mention has been made of hard of hearing or any other. That aside, did Deaf Australia distribute a survey that was along those lines? Did you? And how many responses did you receive?
We received 36 responses. And 90% of deaf people said, yes, please include hard of hearing individuals.
No, that's not my question. My question is, sorry, let me start again. How many members does Deaf Australia have?
All up, 150.
So that's a total of 150, and you have 36 responses.
Yes, that's correct.
The feeling that I have is it's a socialist approach. Yeah? It's a shades of Joe Hocking. Not 50 Shades of Grey, okay? feel it's oppressive. And I'm sitting here questioning my membership to Deaf Australia. That idea should be thrown out with baby in the bathwater. I'm so sorry, it's just rubbish.
Can you please elaborate, Anne, on what it is specifically that you're unhappy with?
Everything, Todd, seriously.
And why is that?
Sorry to be blunt, but I've never heard such nonsense. Seriously, there's no other organisation or association that works this way. Name an organisation that works like this. That's all from me.
Okay, 4 years ago I went to South Africa and we had a conversation with the Deaf Organisation, the National Association of the Deaf and various individuals there. People from Spain, Finland, and quite a number of organisations across the globe, and we had a conversation with 30 different countries who were quite keen on looking at a different way that they could increase revenue raising for their organisations. And we thought it was a fantastic idea. We spoke to many various disability group organisations. Down syndrome was one of them, the Autism Blind Association, AFDO and other disability groups. And they were like, well, we need to have a different process and a different approach. And it is very radical, as you can see. It's very different. It's very challenging. We've never seen anything like this in place before. And many people are looking at this scheme and feel that it will be positive, and it will be a positive response to the many of the issues that we face and many issues other organisations face about how we can increase funding streams and how we can maintain our organisation and how others can maintain their organisations because of the cuts in funding, cuts to employment, various opportunities under the NDIS, and now that government will fund NDIS to support various organisations or individuals, and thinking about other ways how we could support our membership as an organisation. And this is why we've looked into it and thought about what would be effective. And I understand it is very radical. And over time, we may feel, look, we're not quite there yet, but we need to give it time. And then over time, hopefully, we can develop a process and there'll be a positive transition. Job Access, the other organisation, they've been frustrated for quite some time because they provide the e-funding, as you know, the Employment Assistance Fund. And often people are not aware of it. They're dealing with different people with disabilities and they're facing all these barriers around communication. So they're struggling with that concept. And when I've discussed it with Job Access, they've looked at this and they've said they're willing to support Deaf Australia in this process because they do certainly see the benefits there themselves. And they would benefit because we'd be supporting them in being able to do this and support people with other disabilities. And at the same time, we're enhancing our work with our membership to say, look, there's funding and there's resources that people can be referred to. And it means that your access to employment will increase over time also. So again, it's not just thinking about deaf individuals, but talking about the bigger picture and being an inclusive organisation in an inclusive society. So it is about providing access, funding for our organisation.
Thank you, Anne, for your statement and question. We now have a question from someone that's online. So over to Stephen. We've had so many questions being asked online, but here we go. It's really a statement. It's from Janelle Whalen, who's here in Melbourne. And she is saying that the whole process is about having a license. And so we're asking for permission to have an assessment to have this approval process. And this is how it seems.
I appreciate that feedback, Janelle, and I can understand why you might feel like that. There are no other models that currently do exist, so we do need to ensure again that we protect the integrity of Auslan and ensure that it is preserved from now into the future. And if we don't preserve it, then we may in the future no longer have people who are recognised as Auslan users. So we really need to ensure that, you know, we do respect and preserve the language. And if you have any better ideas, please do get back to us and give us that feedback. BCA, the Blind Citizens of Australia, do have an ID card for blind people who don't have driver's licences, so they have an ID card instead. And they have their own particular system that works for their cohort, and their doctor needs to verify they're legally blind and they're provided with an ID number. And that card is used for any official government negotiations where they require access. And that replaces the driver's licence. So that's quite strong in that respect. But I feel their model is quite limited. So we're expanding on that model, if you like. And we're expanding to create further opportunities to be able to broaden our potential of receiving further income streams, and that's the biggest difference, and really creating more awareness and promoting sign language across the country.
Thank you, Janelle, for your question. We're now moving over to Louisa, and she's a mother of a deaf child. Over to you.
My question is, there's obviously a big focus on raising revenue. Why are you focusing more on memberships and the assessments? Why isn't there more focus on fundraising?
That is an important issue, and it is a large challenge because of the funding cuts that we're facing with the various disability organisations. And as a peak organisation, having funding cut from $200,000 a year to what, basically nothing, $20,000 or $30,000 through sales at the Auslan shop, which is all we receive, because of those funding cuts, we're all losing funding. And as you can see, it's a large amount. So it means that we're all competing against one another to revenue raise, and we'll all be applying for various grants that we can no longer receive. And if we apply for 10 grants, like we have prior to Christmas, 10 or 11 grants that we applied for, we've not been successful in any one of those applications. So much more work has to be done here. You know, is there a better way to fundraise rather than approaching government or community grant organisations? Does anybody know a better way? I'm open to it if you've got ideas. A better way for us to be able to raise funds would be fantastic. But if not, where to next? What other options do we have? And could I just add in response to your question, Louisa? Previously we talked about the next steps, and the board decided that we would come up with a deaf-friendly initiative. And we looked at fundraising as well. We're not giving up on other funding streams. The Deaf Friendly Initiative provides larger benefits, more so to the community. Revenue-wise, you know, Kyle said we could receive up to $1 to $2 million. That's optimistic. We may never achieve that target. And also, we don't want to only rely on that aspect for funding. The larger benefits, we can't put a dollar amount on. That's much more beneficial than what you receive, first and foremost, over the dollar amounts that we're able to pull in. We will still apply for funds. We will still explore various funding streams, various grants and projects, and it is a lot of work for Kyle as an individual to take up. Did you want to ask a question?
I just wanted to add, this is all a bit new to me. Like, I have a six-year-old daughter who's profoundly deaf. She also has cochlear implants, so I'm learning Auslan, currently enrolled in Auslan Certificate 2. So I hope to one day be assessed and pass. But, yeah, I guess I'm really hopeful that my daughter will grow up in a world where there's not such a divide between hearing and deaf people. I want it to be more inclusive, you know what I mean? So I would love to get involved however I can with, you know, Deaf Australia or any organisations to help that happen, however I could. Yeah.
Well done, thank you. That's exactly the issue. You know, many deaf people have faced this experience for years and years, and trying to work out how can we be more inclusive and have deaf community members such as deaf children from hearing parents involved. How do we do that? When the hearing parent finds out that their child is deaf, they face so many barriers and negative experiences. And one of the fundamentals of this scheme is to really encourage parents who do have deaf children to seek out appropriate services in different areas where they can provide access to their child, whether it's through learning Auslan or being part of the deaf community. That's paramount. So being included, and with this model, it is an inclusive approach. We're not trying to segregate people and say, look, you can't be part of our community. And that's why we've tweaked the constitution to include hard of hearing members, because many hard of hearing people you know, and not necessarily fluent to begin with, and they learn how to sign later on. And also with children, looking at language development, that is so critical. So it's a good start to ensuring they feel included as part of this scheme.
Thank you, Louisa, for your question. We now have a question from online. Hello. Over to you, Stephen. Online, there's so many questions that have been thrown at us. So I'll give you two questions and then we'll move over to the next person here. So we have Michelle Rollins, she's from Melbourne. She wants to know, with this deaf-friendly initiative, so you pay your fee, you fail, can you actually get your money back? Her second question is from Lorraine Mully, who's from New South Wales. This deaf-friendly initiative was actually approved or ratified at the AGM in Perth. But the thing is, it's not representing the entire hard-of-hearing community out there, because you only had few members there at the AGM. So it's not representative.
Just in relation to the fee, because we need to pay an assessment fee, we need to work out the time around that. So if the person fails, they can become an ordinary member anyway. Secondly, in relation to the sign language symbol, it wasn't approved at the AGM. That's not correct. That's our initiative that we came up with and hasn't gone through the AGM, but we did announce it at the AGM. It's a way of raising revenue for us. I'd just like to clarify what was passed at the AGM was the constitutional changes and the $30 membership, annual membership fee came out of that, and we decided to work with the state branches to focus on a membership fee that we've come up with that's not specific as the previous one.
Thank you to Lorraine and Michelle. Thank you for your questions. We now have a question from Irina. Over to you. Welcome. You can now take the floor. Hi, my name's Irina. Two questions for you. I'm aware that you're wanting to look at revenue and also raise awareness and preserve Auslan here in Australia. The system or the initiative that you have, I'm uncomfortable with. Okay. For the those who are Auslan users, they would feel comfortable with that, okay? But then you have those who have cochlear implants that may not be comfortable with that idea. And remember, it's not Deaf Australia alone. There's also other deaf organisations, and there's lots of competition. And you know, every organisation is trying to raise some revenue. There's Deaf Forum Australia, Deaf Sports Australia, Deaf Children Australia. There's many organisations out there, and it's not Deaf Australia alone. So if we can all unite and be more cohesive, maybe we'll have a stronger case, and that could work. But at the end of the day, I just feel this is going to create more labels. You know, you're deaf, this is deaf friendly, you're too hearing, you're not deaf enough, and this and that. We need to be more inclusive, and we need to strengthen the numbers, and that's how you create diversity. So if you're wanting this deaf-friendly initiative, and I think you can see my point, but I think you need to unite rather than divide.
I think just going back to the Deaf Australia Constitution, we focus on Auslan. It's very clear. We talk about preserving Auslan, the language, and that is our key focus, and has been for many years, is to protect and preserve the language of the Australian deaf people. When I've worked in previous roles, I've had people ask me questions about how many deaf clubs or associations are in Australia, including deaf sports. Do you know how many deaf organisations exist or clubs that are provided? Do you know the numbers? Does anybody in the room know? 360. So there's 360 different deaf clubs, groups, organisations who are providing services. That's a huge amount. So it's very disparate and widespread, and there's different views on that. But what they share is a common goal, and that is the importance of Auslan. So we've tried to think about how can we actually make those groups and clubs and individuals be more included. Not thinking about Deaf Australia or deaf individuals on their own, but how can we have more community engagement and be more inclusive? So it really isn't about fragmenting the individuals or excluding people. So people who are hard of hearing or have cochlear implants who haven't learned sign language, a lot of them struggle to think, okay, which group can I partake in? But, you know, under the deaf-friendly scheme, it doesn't mean that it's only for deaf Auslan users. It's accessible to other people who are willing to learn Auslan. So if a person does have a cochlear implant who may not be fluent in sign language, they can be part of us and learn Auslan along the way. So our main focus really is the preservation and respect that Auslan deserves. Looking at the various questions that are coming, I'm a little bit concerned there's confusion. So with the sign language symbol, that doesn't actually mean it equals the person's deaf. Hearing people can actually receive that symbol as well. So the main idea of that is really for organisations or service providers to be able to provide that symbol. So you can attend a bank perhaps or a cafe, see the symbol and feel comfortable that you can access that service. It doesn't mean that there's a deaf person there. It means that that service is accessible. That's all that symbol means. And that's who we're targeting. It's not deaf people. It's up to you. You don't have to actually apply for that symbol for your own individual purposes. But, you know, organisations who want to provide better services for deaf people might be willing to do that. And who knows, down the track, maybe there'll be more people who want to do that. And again, it's your choice if you want to be assessed or not. You don't have to. Most people here tonight would pass anyway. I'm very confident about that. It'd be very simple for you to pass that process. I'm sure it wouldn't take much at all, but if you're not wanting to go through that assessment process, you still can be a member and support us through the other mechanism. But it's just an additional option for members, and it's entirely up to you. It is your choice.
Thank you, Irina. Before I hand over to another question online, I just need to remind you that we have just under 15 minutes. And I get a feeling, a sense that we won't have time to get through all our questions, so I do apologise in advance. But if you do have a question and you don't have the opportunity, you can always talk with Kyle. I guess maybe you can work out when you can have other discussions outside of this session. So over to Mia, we have a question online. I want want to apologise up front to those who are online. There's been so many questions that have been put forward, but due to time, I won't be able to ask all of those. First question is, I don't know, the person is anonymous. And they're saying that, okay, you're trying to, with this symbol, you're duplicating what the deaf societies are already working with. So why duplicate it? And the second question has come from Bryn Davies. This symbol, this initiative, doesn't really encourage diversity to work together. And his belief is with the symbol, it'd be more effective if deaf organisations were to work together on the same goal. So maybe that's something that you could work towards rather than having this initiative.
What was the first point again, Todd? Sorry, if we could just clarify the first one again. Talking about the duplication, about what the deaf societies do, is that correct with the symbol? Well, the deaf societies or other organisations, Deaf Australia, the state organisations, all provide deaf awareness training, so we do have that scattered throughout, and we're not stopping people from competing with us. I think competition is actually healthy, and how they get the information out there is up to them, the deaf societies or other service providers I may not be completely aware of. But if you're registered as a deaf-friendly organisation, then we have benefits there to be able to work with employers to provide access to information around deaf awareness training through our networks. It doesn't stop us in saying, you know, look, you can't do that. It's not something we're wanting to do. We could outsource the service to different organisations to provide deaf awareness training. There's no problem with that. And it's looking at creating opportunities for deaf awareness training to be provided to employers out there. Many employers aren't aware of EAF, as I mentioned previously. So there's quite a number of awareness-raising initiatives that come out of this, and I do believe competition is healthy. You also talked about working with other organisations. As always is the case, it's important, because at the moment I've told you there's 360 different organisations that operate in Australia. Trying to negotiate with them through MOUs is difficult. We do have some memorandums of understandings with a few other organisations. But having said that, trying to negotiate takes time, as you can imagine. There's issues around funding, and now with the funding cuts through federal government, do I have the time as one person to be able to do all this stuff? Probably not. So the quick fix solution is looking at over time having this initiative in place and possibly reviewing it. But at the moment, it's really thinking about how we can raise funds at a critical point in time where funds will cease. Just in relation to the registry on the sign language symbol, that'll be a public directory where organisations can look at that and actually target people for services they wish to provide. So there is cooperation with employers and also companies where they can actually attract deaf individuals. And it's a great incentive, so it's a win-win situation.
Fantastic. Thank you to that question online. We now have James, and before I hand over to him, I just want you to know that the IT people have said that we can't have any more online questions because we don't have the time left. So those people online, if you have questions that you would like responded to, please give us your name, your email address and your question, and we can then pass that on to either organisation to respond to you. Now, over to Mr. Hale. Thank you. My name's James Hale. I've been involved with a lot of deaf sports clubs over the years, and I've worked in administration as well. Who am I? Am I deaf or hard of hearing? How do I, or who labels me? Who knows my proficiency? Who will assess me as to whether I am deaf or hard of hearing? And that's a question to you.
Thank you for that, James. We do strongly believe that deaf and hard of hearing individuals need an identity, and many hard of hearing children grow up stating that they are deaf, and we respect their right to label themselves as being deaf. So we're not saying you're deaf, you're not, you're hard of hearing. We certainly aren't going around labelling people. It's up to you to identify with whatever you feel comfortable with, and if you want to be hard of hearing, that's fine. That's your identity that you've chosen. And also, the sign language symbol doesn't mean that you're a sign language using deaf person. It means you're proficient in Auslan, that's all. So if you don't receive the symbol, it doesn't mean that you're not recognised as a signing deaf person. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. Thank you, James, for your question. We now move to an online question. Stephen? Stephen and Mia? This question is from Brett Casey, who resides in Queensland. Regardless of the funding cuts, I'm wondering what your approach is to make sure Let me start again. So regardless of the funding cuts and the environment, Deaf Australia needs to consider what they do. Because the culture is alienating. You know, whether one is proficient in Auslan or not. That approach itself is not inclusive when you think about the diversity within the deaf community.
Thank you, Brett. Again, as I mentioned previously, we don't see that as segregating community members. Now, if we want to go to a bank, we face the barrier of organising an interpreter and negotiating that. And because we already feel rejected as a deaf person, we no longer continue with that process. But by having this sign language symbol, it means that I feel comfortable that I can go direct to that organisation and communicate in my first language, and I won't feel excluded from that service, and I'll have a different view. So I think if you think about the scheme, it's really ensuring that deaf people are more included in society, and that barriers to access are not put up, and rather than just being able to access one service, being able to provide several, creating a more inclusive society. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you, Todd, and thank you to Brett. Now moving over to Eden. I think we may have time just for two or three more questions. Thank you, Ryan. I apologise for this cap. Just to let you know, I have ushers. I'm sitting here feeling very uncomfortable. It really goes back to me. I've been a member for many years, but what's the benefit of being a member of Deaf Australia? Is it just online information and you might get a few bits and pieces of, you know, AGM decisions here and there? And I don't feel like there's any benefit to me. It may sound a little bit harsh and a little bit selfish, but I also think it's not just me personally, but also individual members who are deaf. You know, if I'm oral, I'm almost blind, and I can't work, and then I have to pay for this, and I must do this, and I must do that, and then I'm told that, you know, I don't have any proficiency, or, you know, and then there's an extra fee for this and that. It just goes on and on and on, and it's just too complicated. So with this Auslan initiative, we don't care about this. I mean, yeah, it's a great initiative. Go ahead and do it. That's fine. But why do you need our money? why you're an organisation that, yeah, okay, you're looking at revenue and fundraising and things like that, but it's just interesting sitting back here, a very interesting pitch that you have. And I'd like you to respond to that, and thank you.
Thank you, Eden. I think it's a very important question that you raise. What do you receive as members and what do you get from Deaf Australia? And for many years, you paid a $30 fee. $10 went to Deaf Australia and $20 went to the state branch or the state organisation. So the majority of your funds actually went to the state organisation, not Deaf Australia. We received a minimal amount, and obviously we couldn't do a lot with that amount anyway. And deaf people often say, look, what are the benefits? Well, if we had 150 members, it would mean that with $10 each, we'd receive $1,500. What can we offer with that amount? Not a lot, as you can imagine. So this is why we've tried to look at the fee structure to ensure that you do gain more benefits. With the Deaf Friendly Initiative, you only pay $100 as a one-off. You don't have to pay any fees ever again. $30 every year over 10 years equates to what, $300, $400, $500. So this is a one-off fee that we're talking about. So you let me know where you work. I can't work. That's okay. But you've got an option of being an individual member.
But this really focuses, it doesn't focus on the members.
But you could be an individual member and pay $100, and if you don't work or don't have employment, that's absolutely fine. When we collated the information from many deaf individuals, we talked about how we can negotiate with businesses in terms of giving you deals or packages which you've never been provided with before. Business would pay $250, which is, you know, peanuts. They're going to claim it on tax anyway. $250 is absolutely nothing to them, really. But at the end of the day, the deaf community, when we have events and so forth, if we negotiate, you know, a package or sponsorship deal with somebody, we can actually do that. We've got more bargaining power because we've got access to those companies who do have deaf staff and are aware of deafness, and have deaf people working with them. So it's a fantastic opportunity to do business deals with them. And at the end of the day, your benefits increase more than ever before. And, you know, it hasn't actually been established yet. You need to give us time to allow this to happen, and it will happen, I promise you it will. And I can't say, you know, yes or no at this point in time, but it will be happening. Thank you, Eden. It's very important, that question about what do I as an individual get or receive. Members who join up are actually assisting those who are non-members. They benefit more. So if you think about increasing captioning, various services, with the new act last year, I meant that you've got captioning from 6 a.m. till 12 at midnight on various channels, on free-to-air television, and at the same time they thought, okay, well, we'll no longer make the reporting mandatory to the quality of the captioning. And we objected to that, and we did that on your behalf, and that's a benefit you've received. It may not be tangible, but if, you know, you're a member, you're lucky, but the non-member's got a benefit out of it as well. So we're really providing services to the entire community. Kyle spoke about the past where we lobbied government and they'd ask how many members do we have, and we'd have to say 200. And it means that we're not really representing you well enough if that's the stat we're coming up with. We can do better. And with this symbol and the membership system, having a list of life members, we've got the data and the evidence, and that assists us in representing your needs better than we ever have before. And then we can target people within your local area as well. So when government makes a decision about a specific location, we can let the members know in that location what's occurring. And at the moment, we don't have that data. We don't have that bargaining power with the evidence. So this would assist us to provide you with more benefits, not less. And it's not about giving you a piece of paper or giving you a movie ticket. It's about inclusivity. So creating an inclusive environment within the Australian context. And I know it is hard to understand because it's not tangible, but I myself, as a member of Deaf Australia, over the years, you know, thinking when I received a voucher for my TTY, I knew that they did the work, NRS, Deaf Australia did the advocacy work. Without the NRS, I wouldn't be able to do my job. And that's something Deaf Australia did. If we didn't have NABS and my daughter was sick, I wouldn't be provided with an interpreting service. So again, all these benefits you can't necessarily see or think of were provided through Deaf Australia's advocacy work.
Thank you, Carl and Todd. Our final question is from Elizabeth, and she's from Eliza, sorry, and she's from the United States. I'm not sure if it is a question. I'm not proficient in Auslan, but I'll do my best, okay, to use Auslan. And I have someone here at front to help me out. I've actually studied my master's in linguistics at Gallaudet University. And we have the ASL PI. And the reason for that is you have one person who assesses, and some people are not comfortable with that through assessment. And then those who are native users of ASL, who have always used ASL, they may not be up, you know, high up on the level, and they're actually further down on this tier. So they've gone to school, they've actually studied, but they've done a formal exam in ASL, but then, you know, those who are born deaf, there's no assessment, and they're native assigners. So how is that fair?
Just quickly, with the assessment, it's not to assess the person's skills. It's more to say the person is proficient, they can sign, yes or no. It's as simple as that. It's not going into any greater depth. I know with the ASL PI, as an American concept, it's quite detailed. They ask you lots of questions back and forth, and that's not what we're doing. We're asking a question, we're seeking a response, looking at facial expression, non-manual features, the body language, and the person would pass. It's as simple as that. Everybody in this room probably would. It wouldn't be an issue. It's not intensive like the American model. The videos that we will have available online will demonstrate the various categories we're looking at and give you an idea about where you might fit into the system. You're right, some interpreters may achieve the highest ranking because they've studied the language and done linguistics, and a lot of deaf people haven't done that study. So what they've learnt is through their life experience. So we're assessing the social model of signing, not the academic model. So you would probably pass considering the Auslan you provided for us today.
Thank you, Eliza. Thank you for your question. Now that's it. No more questions for tonight. Now before we end this session, I'd like to invite Amani up front again, President of Deaf Victoria, to wrap up this evening's session. What a fantastic night, lots of questions and I guess lots of consideration to be made. And there's been a lot of people that have online, they've actually participated in this. Thank you to Todd and Kyle for responding to many questions this evening. I would like to thank Deaf Victoria Board for taking on all the questions and coming out front. Also thanks to Kyle and Todd and VicDeaf for providing live streaming. We have Niaz and Michael Parrymore, who's worked really hard to set this all up for tonight and to make sure that the technology works. So thank you. And thank you to SLC. We have our two interpreters, Susan Emerson and Mark Quinn. You can see that I'm very tired, so sorry to our interpreters, but thank you again. Great job. And thank you to our captioners, that's Bradley Reporting, for providing captions for tonight. Thank you again. And thank you to Ryan Gook for facilitating tonight. We wanted to ensure that we had a neutral person that would keep the time, and thank you. before we close, we will, I think it's really important that many of you have further questions and would like to discuss this further. So it's important that, look, there's Facebook communication there. There's also a website. We're going to talk further after this session, but look out for information on Deaf Australia and Deaf Victoria's website and Facebook page, because you will have the opportunity to ask those questions. And lastly, a small token of thanks to Ryan for facilitating tonight's session. Thank you so much. Thank you. My pleasure. And it's wonderful to see so many people that are passionate about the deaf community, Auslan, and it's just been wonderful to have you all here tonight. And the live streaming was fantastic. So thank you again, and see you next time. Good night.